This is the New School for Social Research in the spring of 2016. I'm Duncan Foley, and this is the PhD course, Advanced Microeconomics 2, which has the name Information and Behavior in Political Economy. So we're going to, we're getting towards the end of the course. It's warm enough that I'm not wearing my sweater vest today. Maybe by next week I'll have short sleeve shirt on. What we've been doing is working through a series of discussions of the problem of social coordination issues in various parts of political economy. And we started with Smith and Marx. So there was a lecture which actually took three class sections, I think, to get through about Smith and the social coordination problems. It had to do a lot with the specialization and the division of labor. We'll come back to that at the end of this part of the material. And this lecture is about social coordination problems in Marx, and it basically has three parts to it, one of which we did last week was about the division of surplus value, competition and the division of surplus value and the equalization of the profit rate. I think I finished the slides on that, so I'm going to go forward to a second topic, which is social coordination problems having to do with Marx's theory of the falling rate of profit. And then the last, there's a little bit of the lecture, which will, I hope, finish up today and maybe have a little time left over, on alienation and trying to think about the hub and spoke model and the way that Marx thought about alienation and talked about alienation and commodity fetishism. If we do get through all of that material today, maybe we could close the door since there's some noise from outside. If we do get through that, then after a break, I'll go on to the next lecture, which is about social coordination problems in Keynes, in the economics of Keynes, and that will take at least probably two more of the remaining three lectures, so we're only going to have one or one and a half lectures left. I think the last one, I'll try to give a summary lecture on the general point of view behind this way of looking at the world and ensembles, and just it'll be somewhat more abstract, but I think probably you'd be interested in that once you've seen these different applications of the theory. Now, the falling rate of profit, so Marx's theory of the falling rate of profit. I'm going to assume that people are fairly familiar with the broad outlines of this, but I'll just summarize it. We have, in part three of volume three of Capital, Engels edited and pulled together a number of unpublished manuscripts of Marx. And in these particular notes, he outlines some ideas that are based on Ricardo's chapter on machinery in Ricardo's book on the principles of political economy and taxation. Marx looks at this from a somewhat different point of view because he's interested in the implications of Ricardo's ideas on technical change for the long-run tendencies of capital accumulation, and he's particularly interested in what's going to happen with the rate of profit, to get some sense of what the long-run tendencies of the rate of profit are, or factors influencing the average rate of profit in capitalist economy. The outline of his analysis is very interesting, there's been a lot of attention. I mean, there's a huge amount of literature on this particular problem. But most of it focuses on questions of whether you can whether Marx's prediction is true about historical tendencies, measured tendencies in the rate of profit, or whether his logic holds water as a way of predicting what's going to happen to the rate of profit. But if you look at it from a slightly different point of view, you can see that it's very closely connected to the social coordination types of issues that we've been talking about. Because what he argues is that each individual capitalist has an incentive to choose techniques of production to maximize that capitalist's rate of profit. But for some reasons, which we'll go into in more detail, the collective outcome of all the capitalists trying to maximize their individual rates of profit is a fall in the overall rate of profit. That looks like a social coordination problem. That looks like a fallacy of composition, that there's some externality or some influence that the collection of the individual decisions has on what happens to the whole system. And that's the basic theme of these social interaction or social coordination problems. And so what I'm really going to do here is just outline one way of thinking about that. I'd like to underline, incidentally, before we start, that this is just one way. There might be many other ways to introduce these themes in a reading of Marx. So I'm not saying this is the only way, but I'm trying to give you an idea of this as a way of putting this together that makes some sense of it, or I think makes some sense of it. Well, let's begin to set this up a little technically so that we have some notation and we can talk about what's going on. We're thinking of an ensemble of capitalists. So the group of similar or identical agents are a bunch of capitalists, separate capitalist firms. And again, what makes them individual is not that they're different from each other. What makes them individual is the scope of their decision making. That the individual makes a decision over a different set of variables from the collective as a whole. So a typical capitalist hires, let's say, wage labor L. So L is not a very good notation, but I use it anyway. But be careful that you don't get it confused. Actually, it's even worse notation collision on the way, which I'll tell you, which you'll see in a moment. At a wage W, which is determined by the general market for labor power. So the individual capitalist really has no strong control over the W. That's an environmental variable that comes out of how the other capitalists are behaving and how they're interacting with the workers in general. The capitalist has a technology that produces output per worker X. We'll call this X. This is the notation that Tom, Michael, and I used in our book, Growth and Distribution. So if you want to follow this up, you can look at Growth and Distribution to see some other developments of this same idea, which is the value productivity of labor. So X is the amount of use value that that a worker produces. But that requires other inputs, which we think of as capital, or a stock of capital, which might be inventories of raw materials, or it might be machines or factories or transportation equipment or anything of that kind, which is valued at K. So K is the value of the capital tied up in production. The ratio X over K, so that's the output per worker divided by the capital per worker, which is also the total output divided by the total capital, is sometimes called the productivity of capital because it's a ratio of the value output to the capital input by analogy with the X being the ratio of the value output to the labor input. And so it's sometimes called the productivity of capital, but obviously there's some discomfort in doing that if you believe in the labor theory of value and that capital doesn't actually add any value. But we'll just leave this way because that's the way the literature often describes it. So we can think of this capitalist technique of production as being described by any two of these three variables, either X and K, or X and rho, or K and rho, because they're linked through the identity that rho is equal to X over K. So if you know any two of them, you can figure out the other one. If you draw, as we do, this growth and distribution schedule in the growth and distribution book, X is the vertical intercept. We measure output per wage on the vertical axis. Rho is the as a kind of profit rate measured on the horizontal axis, and K is the slope of the line that connects them. So if you know either intercept and the slope, or both intercepts, you can figure out everything else. The individual capitalist has a profit per worker. How much? Well, X minus W, because the capitalist gets output X and has to pay a wage W. So X minus W is what's left over. We're suppressing here the intermediate inputs, so things like the thread that you need to weave the cloth, or the raw cotton that you need to spin the thread, and stuff like that is just being measured in terms of the capital tied up in inventories rather than as an actual flow or unit time. And you're going to get a profit rate then equal to X minus W over K, because the profit rate is defined as the flow of profits, gross profits, divided by the capital tied up. So you can also write that as 1 minus W over X times rho, if you just factor out the rho term. Another convenient way to think about this is we can call omega, Greek letter omega here, the ratio of W to X. And the ratio 1 minus omega over omega is what Marx calls the rate of surplus value realized in the firm, because it measures the ratio of profits to wages, money profits to money wages. And another way to think about this, which is important to keep in mind, is that if the average profit rate is, let's say, R bar, so to distinguish it from this particular firm's profit rate, the difference between the individual capitalist's profit rate and the average is going to be what we'll call R hat, the profit rate deviation, which is R minus R bar. That's going to be X minus W over K minus R bar. So we can write that as X minus W minus R bar K over K. Well, this is as if we are charging the capitalist the average profit rate as a cost of capital. So we take X, we deduct the cost of labor, W, and we deduct the cost of capital. But the cost of capital is the average profit rate times the capital tied up. So you can also think of this as a cost problem, as a cost reduction problem, is the main point here, parallel to the wage W. So you can think of W plus R bar times K as the cost of producing output X when you use the technology that the capitalist is using, L and K. Anybody have any question about this notation? Because I'm going to depend on it pretty heavily in the next few minutes, and don't want to leave any. Well, if you have a question, don't hesitate to bring it up. The drama of the falling rate of profit has to do with the capitalist's choice of technique. When the capitalist, let's say, has been producing and is thinking about adopting another technique. This is the scenario of stuff like industrialization. A capitalist has been running with water power, a water-powered textile mill, and is thinking about introducing steam power and increasing the number of spindles and all that that are going to be spinning thread and employing more labor, maybe, but not in as much in proportion to the increase in the scale of output. We're thinking about an alternative, so we can call the alternative that the capitalist is trying to evaluate X prime, K prime, rho prime. Again, only two of these are independent because of the identity that links rho to X over K to the ratio of X to K. Okay, how does the capitalist, according to Marx or Ricardo, decide whether or not to adopt a technique? So the scenario is some brilliant inventor or somebody comes to the capitalist and says, hey, I have this great new idea, here is how it pans out in terms of your mill. You would now produce X prime number of yards of thread per worker, but you would have to invest K prime in the new machines to do that, or you could think of it that the output per machine would, in this new scheme, be rho prime. And the capitalist is now supposed to think about, is it a good idea to go for this? This is a quite reasonable scenario. I mean, this is definitely the kind of thing that capitalists do all the time. They hire people, sit down with spreadsheets, and cost out alternative business plans and that kind of stuff, which is really what this is a stylized and abstract representation of. It's what Marx, well, at this point it becomes controversial exactly how Marx thought about it, but let's follow our own thinking on this and assume that the capitalist, the individual capitalist, does not think that whether she adopts this technique or not is going to affect the wage. So she now sees herself as just one of, you know, a very small factor in the situation, and that she can make a decision that will not involve any of the other capitalists, and therefore that the wage will stay the same. So the terms of her best response, if you think about it in terms of the social interaction model or Nash equilibrium, are that she's going to calculate whether she wants to adopt the technique or not on the basis of assuming that the wage won't change. All that's going to change is output per worker, her investment per worker, the X prime and the K prime. Well, in that case, her new profit rate, the profit rate she's going to assign to this alternative technique, is what? Well, it's, we'll call it R prime of W. W, notice, does not have a prime on it because we're assuming that it's constant. And that's going to be X prime minus W because you have to pay the same amount per worker. You just get a different output per worker, the X prime, and you're going to divide it up over K prime. The capital, the new capital stock, K prime. This is clearly a very stylized version. What's going to happen in real capitalist production is that you're going to have several plants. When you do this kind of thing, it's at the time that you're going to build another plant, or when one of the plants has become so old and decrepit that you're going to tear it down and replace it. So all of this represents as a kind of a single decision. It really represents what in historical terms is going to be a gradual transition from one technology to another, probably. But it's the lessons of it are still quite worth learning, and you could make the necessary changes easily to accommodate a gradual or marginal change in technique. Alternative techniques where the profit rate rises, this Nobuo Okishio calls viable. And the idea there goes back to Smith's notion that what capitalists are interested in is the profit rate. He says, well, what capitalists are seeking, they're going to move their capital around in search of a high profit rate, not necessarily total profits or something like that, but profit rate. And that's, as we saw last week, that's the key to understanding this high degree of organization of profit rates in that tent map, like data that Scharfenacker and Semyonyuk recovered from the CompuStat data. So we're still on the same track that we're thinking the payoff for a capitalist is profit rate. That's the key idea. So a change is viable if it raises the profit rate. If it lowers the profit rate, the capitalist is going to go turn to the inventor and say, back to the drawing board, right? Okay, that one doesn't work for me, because if I adopt it, it's going to lower my profit rate. And I'm not interested in lowering my profit rate. I'm interested in raising my profit rate. Anybody have any question about viability or this little scenario of the capitalist looking at an alternative technique of production? All right, let me test you a little bit. Keep everybody on their toes. Suppose that I'm a capitalist and I find that an alternative technique is viable at some wage, at the going wage. Does that necessarily mean it would be viable at a higher or lower wage? You know the answer, but let's see if anybody else could come up with the answer. Oriol.
It's like the W divided by X.
Yeah, we can try to get the microphone.
I mean, if you increase the X more than Y, you can still actually like make a viable technique with an increase in a wage.
Well, you can certainly find values of X prime and K prime that are viable. I mean, for example, I can come to you and say, hey, we're going to spin thread out of air, right? We don't need any machines at all. So we're going to get an infinite amount of thread per worker. And that's going to be viable. It's just not going to be technically feasible because nobody really knows how to get thread out of air. But the question is, what about the W? If we change W around, could it change the viability of the technique? Jang, you can tell.
Here. If they change the profit rate, so if it changes the wage rate, then definitely changes the profit rate. So that must be the same.
You get the microphone, so you say that.
So if we change the wage rate, then definitely we have to change the profit rate, which means we change the reference point. So the viable condition should change as well.
Could change. And so what's viable at one wage might not be viable at some other wage.
Yeah.
And vice versa. What's not viable at some wage might be viable at a different wage. So just you can see in the Growth and Distribution book some drawings that illustrate that. Maybe I should have put a drawing, a figure in here for that. The innovation possibilities frontier. There's a very influential model of technical choice that was developed. It actually is based on some ideas of John Hicks in the early 1940s, but it became a major theme in the macroeconomic growth literature in the 1960s with the publication of Charles Kennedy's 1964 paper on induced technical change. Christian von Weizsäcker had developed very similar ideas about the same time, and later published on that, and Solow and Samuelson published some papers about that, and it's actually spawned a significant literature that you can follow out. If you want to follow that literature, I have the citations in my 2003 JBEL, Journal of Economic and Behavior, Journal of Economic Behavior and Organization article. There's also a very interesting paper by Gerard Dumanil and Dominique Levy that develops much the same idea from a stochastic basis. So their idea is that the capitalists, that sort of new ideas, new technical possibilities arise stochastically. There's some kind of stochastic process. And then the capitalist has to decide stochastically whether to adopt or which of them to adopt. And it gives qualitatively rather similar results. But we'll look at the Kennedy one because it's the best known one and was the first published one. And if you understand it, then you get the idea. Kennedy assumes, in the language of the social interaction model, that the typical firm, he doesn't call it the typical firm, he thinks of it as the whole economy. Okay, but we're thinking of it as a typical firm that is one of many firms facing similar choices. It faces what he calls an innovation possibility frontier, or IPF, which define the available combinations of rates of increase of labor and capital productivity. So the idea is that the capitalist obviously would like to have infinite increases in labor productivity and capital productivity, but the world isn't like that, so you have to make the best choice you can under some kind of constraint, which is the innovation possibility frontier idea. We can represent the trade-off between rates of change of labor and capital productivity, and here we have the slightly unfortunate fact that I'm using the same variable, gamma, to mean the rate of change of labor productivity, but gamma already has a meaning in our notation for the social interaction model, so I really need to, you have to keep those two things clear, and unfortunately they link up. And we'll use the notation Greek letter chi for the rate of increase of capital productivity. So we can think of the innovation possibility frontier as a concave function. If we have plot gamma on the vertical axis and chi on the horizontal axis, then gamma versus chi is supposed to produce some kind of a constraint set that says, all right, you are the capitalist, you get to choose where you're going to land on that constraint set, but you can't land outside the constraint set because there aren't any techniques like that, at least right now. Now, maybe after a couple of years go by, there's going to be technical advances and that constraint set would move out and some techniques that were not feasible, technically feasible, would become feasible. But at any one moment, the capitalist has to make a choice. The growth rate of the typical capitalist profit rate with the adoption of a new technology is going to be what? Well, we take the logarithmic derivative of r, which is 1 over r dr dt, sometimes called r hat, but I use r hat as a different concept, and we can work out exactly what that is by just doing calculus. And we find that it's equal to chi, the increase in capital productivity, plus a very interesting factor times gamma, namely the increase in labor productivity. And the weight that occurs on labor productivity is actually the rate of the inverse of the rate of exploitation. It's omega, the labor share, divided by 1 minus omega, the profit share. This was a very useful observation that Kennedy made. Because you see, what it does is that it links up technical change to distribution at a very fundamental level. It says, well, suppose that the labor share is very large, then that's going to predispose you to choose high rates of labor augmenting technical progress. And if the labor share is very small, it's going to predispose you to choose high rates of capital augmenting technical progress because of the way that this ratio works. If you're the typical capitalist and you're trying to maximize the growth of your prospective profit rate through the adoption of new techniques, then we can set this up as a mathematical programming problem. You're going to try to choose gamma or chi, well, let's say gamma, to maximize the, which is the rate of increase of labor productivity, which to, in order to maximize the rate of growth of your profit rate, and we know that that's equal to chi plus omega over 1 minus omega times gamma. But this is subject to the innovation possibility frontier, which is gamma has to be equal to g of chi, or less than, but we're going to assume you at least go for the frontier if you can. And this leads, just doing this as a Lagrangian problem, which we don't have to do, but if you're interested in it, I suggest you just work this out because it's a useful exercise. It leads to the first order condition that the rate of exploitation should equal the negative of the slope of the innovation possibility frontier at the point that the typical capitalist chooses. And if you think about what that means, it means that the higher the share of labor costs in total costs, the more there will be a bias towards labor saving technical progress and possibly even capital using technical progress, because you are going to want to emphasize lean towards, bias your technical change towards the more, the input which is the largest share of your costs, if you have this type of choice between labor and capital. So this is all in the literature, and you can go back to the Kennedy or to my 2003 paper, or to a number of different sources to see the derivation of this kind of induced technical change logic. But I want to today look at it more in terms of the social interaction model. So let's suppose that the action of the typical firm, or the typical capitalist, that is the best response of the typical capitalist, is this chi of omega. Typical capitalist assumes the wage is going to stay constant, so assumes that the distribution is given, and equalizes, chooses this marginal, satisfies this marginal first order condition, and that's going to determine a certain degree of labor productivity increase and a certain degree of capital productivity increase. And given that the innovation possibility frontier puts limits, it might be that the that this is going to actually increase labor productivity and diminish capital productivity, because you may have to make a such a big investment in machines, in the value of the machines that are required, that you're going to lower the capital productivity, but you're willing to do that because labor is such a big share of your costs that it's worth it to you to get the labor productivity up and reduce the wage costs of your output. So that's the best response of the typical firm. And you can see that if in this story there is no impact of the average rate of capital productivity increase of the other firms on best response. As long as the average rate of capital productivity of increase of the other firms doesn't affect the wage. Because the key assumption that we made here was that each individual firm takes the wage as given. So if you're thinking in terms of the social interaction model, this best if we measure chi bar, the or gamma bar, the technical change pattern of all the other firms on the horizontal axis, the best response of this firm is just going to be a horizontal line. It's not going to exhibit either strategic substitutability or strategic complementarity. If you're interested in this as a research topic, and I think it's a very important research topic and you might want to get interested in it, this is by no means the only way to tell this story. Because there might be a whole variety of scenarios in which there is an impact of the average choice of the other firms on the choice of a given firm, on the choice of the typical firm. And that might take place either through an impact on wages, that's actually what I'm going to talk about more, or it might be through some other channels. Maybe the firms are competing on quality or something of that kind. And therefore, if you're going to keep in the market at all and the other firms are moving to a different technology, you have to keep up. So it pushes you to do sort of the same thing, and you could get some degree of strategic complementarity. Just because I'm telling the story in this very simple, vanilla way doesn't mean that's the only way to tell the story. And if you're interested in the contagion of technical change issues, then you can use the social interaction model in other ways to represent that. Okay, let me just pause for a moment. So is everybody on board as to the best response of the typical firm doing this induced technical change problem? Or is there a question about it? Okay, I'll assume we're okay and we'll see about questions down the line. Now it's interesting, a very interesting exegetical point about reading Marx stuff in Volume 3 of Capital, is that in that discussion, Marx introduces the assumption not of a constant wage, but of what he calls a constant value of labor power. Now, for Marx, the value of labor power is the proportion of the working day that the productive worker has to work in order to reproduce herself, that is to produce the commodities required to survive and reproduce. So that is the value of labor power is a ratio. It's a proportion of the working day. If productivity of labor is constant, which is the assumption of much of the analysis in the rest of Capital, then clearly the value of labor power is just another way of talking about the wage. The higher is the wage, the higher is the value of labor power. The lower is the wage, the lower is the value of labor power, because you're holding the productivity of the typical worker constant. So there really doesn't make any difference whether you talk about a constant wage or a constant value of labor power. But now we're in the context of a change in technology, and we're thinking specifically about adopting technologies where what the worker produces changes. Well, in that case, the assumption of a constant value of labor power is quite different from the assumption of a constant wage. Because the assumption of a constant value of labor power says, for example, suppose that the productivity of the individual worker goes up, then the wage should go up in the same proportion. Because you want to keep the proportion of the working day required to produce the subsistence of the worker constant. That's what the constant value of labor power means. Or vice versa, if for some reason the average productivity of workers goes down, then a constant value of labor power lowers the wage. It means a smaller wage. Or to put it another way, if you increase the productivity of the typical worker and you hold the wage constant in real terms, then the value of labor power goes down, right? Because the worker is more productive, so it takes her a shorter part of the working day to produce the subsistence bundle. So we're now in a different world, and it's interesting that Marx changes his language at that point. And if you're interested in this Marx, close reading of Marx stuff, then you might want to look at that really again or carefully and see just how he does phrase his results in this area. But if we hold the value of labor power constant in terms of the social interaction model, it means that the wage for the typical firm depends on the average productivity of labor, which is X bar. That is, that's X bar is the productivity of labor in all the other firms, right, in the average of the other firms. So we now have W as a function of X bar, and that's going to equal this omega. Now it's omega, the wage share, that we're holding constant, not the wage. And the wage itself is going to vary. All right. Now, at this point, let me mention briefly a very significant paper on this by a brilliant Japanese Marxist economist, Nobuo Okishio, who in the early 60s pointed out, perhaps phrasing the problem in a less than optimal way, but certainly correctly, he said, well, if the wage remains constant, not the value of labor power, but the wage remains constant, then any viable technical change that promises to raise the profit for an individual producer will actually raise the profit even when it is universally adopted. So there's no fallacy of composition here if we hold the wage constant. There's a big literature on this has been very upsetting to Marx loyalists, because they argue that the Okishio theorem rebuts or refutes the theory of the falling rate of profit. I don't particularly think so, because it deals with a different case, namely a constant real wage, from the one that Marx was interested in, himself argued through, which was the constant value of labor power. And it also seemed to me that it was a little bit misguided historically, because if you look at the broad sweep of capitalist development, you see that the wage tends to rise with capital accumulation and with the industrialization of production. And in fact, although it's very uneven and it's not by any means a strict proportional law, over most of the sweep of capitalist development, the wage tends to rise about at the same rate as labor productivity, so that the value of labor power does not change a whole lot. It goes up and down in certain periods. In mainstream economics, this is called Boley's law. This is one of these many examples of what's called Stigler's law. Stephen Stigler, the brother of the economist George Stigler, was a historian of thought, a broad, not just of economic thought, but of social thought and statistical thought in general. And in a puckish moment, he said, you know, I believe that nobody's that whenever people get something named after them, it's almost certain they didn't invent it. So it's you could think of it that way, and I think that's probably true of Boley's law, that Boley didn't think of it, but it's what it's called, Boley's law, which is, roughly speaking, a constant value of labor power. But there's a final wrinkle on this that's very important, which is that in the past 25 years in the advanced capitalist countries, Boley's law doesn't seem to hold anymore. Because wages in the United States and in Europe and even in Japan as well, since 1975 or 1980, have not kept pace with measured labor productivity increase. And that's a very important fact, which no one seems to have a very good handle on. It's become a big issue in political issues, say, in this current US presidential campaign, where there's a revolt of the middle, what Americans like to call the middle class, which is everybody except the 1%, since all Americans believe that they're above average. It's the Garrison Keillor effect, or the Lake Wobegon effect. Everybody has to be above average. But you don't have to be in the 1%, you just have to be above average, so you can. And still, if your wages are stagnating, your standard of living is stagnating, even if you're in the 60th percentile or something like that, and you're sore as hell, and you're not going to take it anymore. So you don't like that. So I think that Okishio's theorem, first of all, you want to be very careful with it, because you want to be very clear what his assumption is and how it relates to Marx's discussion about the constant value of labor power. But you also want to think about it in terms of the historical context in which you are applying it. Because for most of capitalist development, the assumption of a constant real wage is not correct. The real wage tends to rise, roughly speaking, along with productivity of labor. You hardly ever see it's very unusual to see the kind of stagnation of wages that we have been experiencing. Okay, well, let's look now at the logic of the technical change problem, assuming a constant value of labor power, or what's basically the same thing, a constant wage share in value added. Now what happens? Okay, so now the typical capitalist takes account of the dependence of the wage on labor productivity in the system as a whole. So now she thinks, what is her prospective profit rate going to be? It's going to be R is 1 minus omega. Well, that's constant. The wage share is constant. But what she's going to stick in there is not her labor productivity, but the average labor productivity that all the other capitalists are achieving. And she's going to divide that by her labor productivity, because omega x bar is the wage. That's what we just saw up here in equation 16. And x is her output per worker. So she's going to ask herself, well, what happens to this profit rate when I change, if I change technology to adopt a different X and a different rho, different labor productivity and a different capital productivity? Well, now we can again take the time derivative of this profit rate, but it has a somewhat different form, because you have this X bar term in it, as well as the X term. Presumably, we're not going to change X bar. She doesn't think that her adoption of a new technique is going to change the average rate of labor productivity in the system as a whole. You find that the rate of change of profits is the same as before, chi plus omega over 1 minus omega times gamma. Her rate of change But there's another term that corresponds to the average rate of change of labor productivity of all the other capitalists, gamma bar. And that's clearly negative. And you can see why it's negative, because as the other capitalists raise the their labor productivity, they're pushing up the wage. So there's an externality. Okay, now we're definitely in social coordination territory, right? Because we have an interaction between the individual capitalist's decision and the outcome for everybody else, or vice versa. You can think of it as an interaction between what everybody else does and the outcome for the typical capitalist, which is not being taken account of in the typical capitalist's decision. She's not internalizing this externality. And the externality, according to the assumption of the constant value of labor power, is that when the individual capitalist or any capitalist raises the rate of labor productivity, an unintended consequence or an uninternalized consequence is that it raises the wage for all the other capitalists. So even if you take into account the fact that, you have an externality of the kind that drives the social interaction model. It's still going to be the case that in equilibrium, X has to equal X bar. That is, the typical capitalist has to have the same technology, make the same technology choice as everybody else, because they're all identical. So the whole idea of equilibrium is just like it is before. But when we see the mathematical programming problem, we see that, in fact, the rate of change depends on what everybody else does. But in fact, the maximizing choice of chi does not depend on what everybody else does, because what everybody else does is just an additive externality. It's just something that drags down on the profit rate of the individual capitalist. But it leaves her incentives in terms of the bias of technical change exactly the same. But this externality through the change in the wage does lower the rate of increase in the profit rate that's achievable. This is then a case where where there's a additive externality in the social interaction model. It's not that beta is not equal to zero, that there's social strategic complementarity, but it's that what I called, unfortunately, gamma in the social interaction model, which is now going to get confused with the gamma that's the rate of increase of labor productivity, imposes an externality. What does that mean? It means that the social coordination level of bias of technical change, that is the one that would maximize the rate of profit for everybody. So if the capitalist could choose both gamma and gamma bar, she would make a different choice than if she is choosing her own gamma, assuming that everybody else is not going to follow suit. So there's no strategic complementarity or substitutability, but the equilibrium is not socially coordinated because of this externality through the wage effect. And that means that there's going to be too high a rate of labor augmenting technical progress, which means too low a rate of capital augmenting technical progress. And in particular, that effect could be strong enough that the profit rate would actually be falling over time, despite the fact that all of the capitalists are constantly choosing new techniques that they think are going to raise their individual profit rate. But they get caught out by the wage externality eventually catching up with them and driving down the overall rate of profit. Well, I would argue that that's, now this is, we get into very technical questions about reading Marx, and you can go back and see if you see any or what traces of this interpretation you see in Marx. But it seems to me that the, yeah, okay, Daniel has a question.
Thank you. So by the same token, it is possible to increase the rate of profit even though the wages are being pulled back.
It might be that you that the way that you want to increase the rate of profit overall would be to lower the rate of labor productivity, or at least not to allow it to rise so rapidly. Okay, Daniel, let me repeat the question. The question is, how would you raise the rate of profit? And according to this, you have to look at the math, you have to look at the mathematical expressions, but
sorry, no.
It may very well be that the best you can do is to leave the labor productivity constant or something like that, depending on just where the innovation possibility frontier is.
Because you said that it is possible that even all the capitalists are trying to maximize, even though they are trying to maximize the rate of profit, the end result will be a downward trend in the rate of profit?
Yes.
Because this externality?
Because they don't take account of the externality, and you see that in the social interaction model. That's a case where the equilibrium is not socially coordinated because of the internalized externality. Yeah. From the point of view of the capitalists. Now, maybe this is a good thing for society as a whole, because this may mean that capitalism, this also is a very strange part of maybe Marx's, understanding Marx's argument. You might argue, well, that's a bad thing for the capitalists, but it's a good thing for society. Because what it means is that capitalist production has a bias in favor of increasing productivity and increasing the standard of living of workers faster than it really ought to if it was not subject to this social coordination problem. This is a point of view I don't think Marx brings out very well, because Marx was not prone to bring out anything good that the capitalist system did for society. Even if he possibly saw that lurking around the corner, I doubt that he would have made it explicit. But I think it is implicit if you adopt this this point of view. It also means, incidentally, let's update this to current political economy. It also means that if there really is a failure of this mechanism that's raising the real wage along with labor productivity, this mechanism is going to also fail. This technical change mechanism is going to fail, and there's going to be lower rates of increase of labor productivity and lower rates of increase in standard of living, because the engine of capitalist progress, or if you want to think about it that way, depends somehow on this externality that keeps the value of labor power roughly speaking constant. Okay, we're almost to the end of this, so then we'll take a little time out. So the social interaction model provides a useful framework for understanding Marx's discussion of the falling rate of profit. Whether you find it completely convincing either as an interpretation of Marx, I leave up to you. I mean, you want to go and read the Marx texts and see what you think. But it seems to me the logic of it holds together in terms of the social interaction model. There really is a case to be made that there's an uninternalized externality implicit in this story. And it is the constant value of labor power that introduces that. And that immediately points up the limits of the Okishio theorem. Because if we include that externality, then the Okishio theorem is no longer true. Okishio's theorem basically says if there's no externality, then if every capitalist increases her rate of profit, the average rate of profit has to increase, right? That's one way of phrasing the Okishio theorem. So the refutation of the Okishio theorem from this point of view lies precisely in recognizing the social interaction aspects of this question. But there may be further elaborations of this general model, and I just threw it out here because I'd like to get people interested in it, and if some people want to pursue it further. For example, Anwar Sheikh has theories of what he calls real competition, which is a much broader theory of competition than just lowering costs and increasing the profit rate. And I'm quite convinced, I haven't sat down and done it, but somebody could do it, that some elements of what Sheikh calls real competition would imply a strategic complementarity or strategic substitutability in the choice of technique problem. And that would be an interesting model, because that would be not just that the social interaction gamma is not equal to zero, but that the social interaction beta is not equal to zero, and you would have some kind of cumulative causation effect in technical change. I tend to believe that Marx, like most of the great social theorists, had a very clear idea of the social coordination problem and thought that the social interaction type of logic was what social theory was about. He did not think social theory was about the first fundamental welfare theorem, that if everybody maximize their own payoff, then the social payoff, then the social outcome would be socially coordinated. Well, I think what he meant by a contradiction or the contradictory nature of capitalist social relations was precisely that they involved a large number of uninternalized externalities that meant that the outcomes were irrational from the point of view of society, even though they were rational from the point of view of the decentralized individuals, the decentralized firms, or the decentralized producers who were making the decisions. And this example of the falling rate of profit, I think, is a very, I find it a pretty persuasive example. Let me see if you have any discussion of that, or well, oh, Daniel, yes. You already have the microphone. Well,
sorry. Just in case this is the last point of this
This subsection. Yeah, we'll talk a little bit more about alienation after the break. Yep.
Another point about a possible social coordination problem. In your 2003 Gordon lecture, in the paper in the Review of Radical Political Economy, you mentioned another source of possible coordination problem. The forms in which firms appropriate surplus value or generate profits, rents, interest, it's determining the way that the system as a whole generates surplus value.
Yeah.
So by trying that each firm to appropriate shares of greater shares of surplus value, they are at the same time reducing, or there's a bias in the reduction of the sources of surplus value. So I don't know if you have some thoughts about it.
Yeah, well, that's a very good, this is a very good point to say a little bit about that. Daniel is referring to a talk that I gave a couple of years ago called the Gordon Lecture at the URPI session at the ASSA. And in that, I made the point that if you think about it, the theory of surplus value is divided into two parts. And it's very clear, actually, in the first volume of Capital. Marx says, well, how does increases in productivity increase benefit the capitalists? And he's very explicit about this. He says, only insofar as increases in labor productivity lower the value of labor power. Because it's only if increases in labor productivity lower the value of labor power that there's more of the working day left over to be surplus labor and therefore to turn into surplus value. Then in the third volume of Capital, he makes the point in his discussion of the transformation problem, if I believe if you read it correctly, that there's really no systematic relation at the level of individual capitalist production between the amount of surplus labor that a capitalist extracts from his productive labor through exploitation and the amount of surplus value that that same capitalist appropriates through competition on the market. Now you can see that there's a rough correlation here. There's a rough statistical correlation. One of the ways that capitalists can get a competitive advantage is to lower costs. And if they're lowering costs, takes the form of increasing the ratio of unpaid labor to paid labor, then they are contributing something to the pool of surplus value. But that's not their main goal. Their main goal is to maximize the amount of surplus value they take out of the pool of surplus value, which is mostly generated by other capitalists. So you have the same kind of social coordination, free-riding kind of problem. I mean, it's somewhat eerie and maybe a little scary because it tells you that this whole system is very contingent. You know, it's not, I mean, which really I think is Marx's message. He's saying, you think this system is a rational system to increase the standard of living of British workers or American workers or anybody, but it's not. It's a system to pursue surplus value, and if it increases the standard of living, it's just by accident, just a contingent byproduct of the competition among capitals. It would be more comforting if in our great wisdom here at the New School we had in the computer the plan B for how you're going to organize social production given the hub and spoke technology so that it would be socially rational, right? But as you know, we didn't quite lick that problem when we attacked it a couple of weeks ago. Okay, let's take a break for a few minutes. Okay, here we are after break, and we'll switch gears slightly to the final topic of this broad lecture on social coordination problems in Marx, which these are by no means an exhaustive survey of these questions. You could the question Daniel asked before the break is a very good example of a very important one. Another important social coordination problem that's linked to Marx. And there's a lot of other, I mean, if you start looking, you'll probably find them all over the place, actually. Start thinking that way. But I was particularly interested in, as I was thinking through the hub and spoke model, that I thought I saw some interesting relation between the hub and spoke model and things that you read in Marx's writing on alienation, which is very, those texts on alienation are very popular. They strike a chord with people almost instantly because everybody feels alienated all the time in modern capitalist society. And so psychologically they're very compelling. And it might even be that because they're psychologically so compelling that we don't look at them quite closely enough in terms of their analytical content. What I was thinking was, let's go back to the hub and spoke model. So the hub and spoke model says, all right, what the division of labor does is that it puts the typical producer in a kind of a dilemma. And here's the dilemma. The typical producer can diversify. Let's say diversification, roughly speaking, is traditional, more or less self-sufficient agriculture. Maybe it's self-sufficiency at the level of the feudal manor or something like that. So there's more than one person involved or more than one family involved, and it has its own social relations like serfdom and manorial rights and all that kind of stuff. But still, the manor is largely supposed to be a self-sufficient unit of production. It produces its own food, its own clothing, and all those kinds of things. So you have the choice between participating in that, which you might even think, well, it's exploitative and feudal production is horrible, but it's not alienated because it's personal. You know, even if you're the serf and you're tugging your forelock to the lord all the time, you know who he is. I mean, and you see him every day, and you have a personal relation with him. You see a little hint of this in the Downton Abbey stuff, right? About the upstairs and the downstairs, and the question of who's really happier? Is it really the rich lord and his neurotic, troubled family, or is it the tenants on the farm who are mostly concerned about whether their sheep are breeding right or something? I don't know. But anyway, you could imagine that. And then the typical producer is offered this other choice. Well, what is the other choice? The other choice is to specialize, which abstractly in the hub and spoke model means going to one of these spokes and doing one thing and becoming very good at one thing. Now, that probably involves a whole bunch of other changes in people's lives. For example, it's much more likely that when you specialize, you're going to live in a city than in the country. There's going to be a bunch of many other things. And if the way you specialize is through capitalist production, you're going to become a wage laborer. So you're going to have antagonistic relations of production with your capitalist employer and many of the other things that Marx talks about. But some of Marx's writing on alienation is really not about exploitation. It's about the division of labor itself and the problems that the commodity organization, or the organization of the division of labor through commodity exchange, pose for the individual typical producer. Basically, those problems, I think, if you read Marx carefully, have to do with the fact that exchange is an inherently antagonistic relationship. But if you think about the whole idea of the division of labor, it's basically a socially cooperative relationship. What's the motive for engaging in the social division of labor? The motive is to increase your standard of living by cooperating with, we called it K minus one other producers, in which each of you go and specialize in one thing, and then by pooling the output, your higher output, you all get a higher standard of living. Well, that sounds like cooperative. But if you can only make that an equilibrium by introducing exchange of the products as commodities, then you are representing this basically cooperative opportunity as an antagonistic relation between the producers. And not only that, but the typical producer, in the way that we're looking at it, is just like all the other typical producers, or more or less like them. Now, you know, we don't have to push that too far, but in relevant respects, all the typical producers are kind of in the same boat. They all are facing this same dilemma or this same choice. And therefore, there's a certain violence that's being done when the typical producer finds herself in an antagonistic relation with whom? Well, with herself, or somebody who's just like herself, that she can't really tell the difference. And she, Marx writes about this in his writing about alienation quite a bit, these mirror kind of effects of the division of labor, where you see yourself in the other party, but you can't reach out to yourself and solve the problem, solve the social coordination problem, because the social relations of production are commodity relations that are antagonistic. In economic discourse, the diversified producer is Robinson Crusoe. And you can begin to see why the Robinson Crusoe image is so powerful. And you can also begin to see why there's a big difference between the social interaction model's concept of the typical producer and mainstream economics' concept of the representative agent. Because the in one sense, they look the same, right? The representative agent is presumably because everybody's exactly the same. If you look at Lucas's model of asset pricing, the curious thing about it is that everybody's the same, and they all have the same preferences, and therefore they all put the same price on risk, and therefore on different securities. And that explains the prices of the securities, but it doesn't explain why there's ever any transactions in the securities, because if everybody's exactly the same, why bother, really? That's just like Robinson Crusoe would have the same problem of risk and return, of balancing risk and return. That means to me that the representative agent is not the same as the typical producer, because the typical producer is alienated or is divided from herself by the division of labor, by being located at some particular spoke of this wheel, of this production wheel representing specialization. These slides that I'm going past, I think basically review these points. So the typical producer in a specialized division of labor sees herself mirrored in the other producers of other goods. As in the social interaction model, the other producers are, in relevant respects, just like herself, and together they share the same overall goal, which is to produce as high an average standard of living as possible, given the technological possibilities. But as the social interaction model dramatizes, the separation of the collective producer into individualized, specialized producers creates a social coordination problem that does not exist for the diversified producer. The diversified producer, like Robinson Crusoe, internalizes all of these allocational conflicts. If all the specialized producers could act in their common interest, they could achieve their shared goal, but their separation as individuals condemns each of them to best response behavior. Now, this is going pretty far, because this is suggesting that what Marx calls alienation is Cournot-Nash equilibrium. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if that's true or not. Maybe that's not, maybe that is going too far. On the other hand, it's not going completely the wrong direction, because it's pretty clear that that is one of the things that Marx is trying to get at when he talks about alienation and commodity fetishism, that they are, that they involve exactly those aspects of behavior that we in modern economic theory call best response behavior or Nash equilibrium. Marx uses that, so this is a question of understanding Marx's terminology, which I think is a vastly underestimated question. We tend to just accept Marx's terminology. For one thing, he wrote in German, and then somebody translates it into English, so this word becomes alienation, but it's really a German word, and what it meant to Marx, we really don't completely know. And then we say, well, Marx is writing about some different world or something like that. But suppose he's really writing about a world that overlaps quite a bit with the modern, social theory. And it's just the terminology that's getting in the way. So I'd argue that it's at least worth a try to think about what happens if we assume that Marx is using the terminology of alienation to describe and analyze the plight of the collective producer divided up into these individual pieces. And it's the dividing up that's the alienation effect. To the degree that individual producers succeed in overcoming the separation imposed by the division of labor and acting in their collective shared interests, they also overcome the alienation. I think this is a quite important part of Marx's politics. And it's why his notion that the solidarity of a proletarian political movement is closely allied to its political economic goals in transforming the relations of production. The opposition of the individual to the mass of other identical individuals militates against this. And you can see this is a big theme in bourgeois ideology. So what does bourgeois ideology always insist? It always insists that there's no collective, right? There's only the mass of individuals. I think Mrs. Thatcher said this once. There isn't any society. All there is are a bunch of individual people. I think she got that from Hayek or somebody, or indirectly from Hayek. Well, is it really true? No, it's not really true if we live in a world of this kind of high complementarity of specialized effort. It's not really true. There is a society, there has to be a society. We're bound together not just by sort of voluntary affinities, you know, looking for companionship or friendship or something like that. You're really bound by a very practical issue, which is the division of labor and the need to organize the division of labor and the relations through which you organize the division of labor. But what does it look like to the individual? The way it looks to the other, to the individual, and Marx makes a great deal of this, as does other social theory, which is that in these social interaction equilibria, the actions of others weigh very heavily on the typical individual. In fact, they weigh so heavily that they basically shape your behavior. Your behavior becomes conditional on what everybody else does. And this gets expressed all the time in such ideas as, well, if I don't do it, somebody else will do it. So I might as well do it. You know, if I refuse to be the concentration camp guard, somebody else will be the concentration camp guard. And the only effect is going to be that I'm going to have to take a lower paid job. It's not going to help the concentration camp victims at all, is the extreme of it. I mean, not all decisions are as fraught with human consequences as that particular one, where the dilemma becomes really excruciating, I think, to people. Well, what about free will? Sure, the individual has free will, and the individual in the social interaction model exercises free will, but how? By doing a best response, by choosing the best response. Ultimately, in the social interaction model, it's the best response of all the individuals that determines what happens, what the social outcome is, right? There's nothing else. But from the point of view of the individual, the actions of everybody else appear as if they were an external constraint, rather similar, say, to physical laws. And this is another theme of bourgeois ideology, right? That it's human nature, and that the reason the world is the way it is not because people are behaving a certain way, but because they have no choice but behave that way. Well, at one level in the social interaction model, that's true. You don't have any choice except the degree of choice that you exercise through your best response. But it turns out that that degree of choice may be incredibly weak and ineffectual in an equilibrium situation. You just can't do anything about it because you're just... And it's even more frustrating because you know that if you could talk to every one of those other people as individuals, they would feel exactly the same way you do. But you can't talk to them all as individuals. They're just out there. Okay, that's the discussion of the alienation. Does anybody want to raise any comments or questions about that? And then we can start a little bit on Keynes. A little too much. Okay. Well, I'm going to start, even though we only have a few minutes left, because we don't have very much time left in the whole course. So I want to make sure that we get these ideas, have a chance to discuss these ideas. Now we're shifting gears to what I call lecture 8 in the big lectures, that are not coordinated with the specific class sections. Which has to do with social coordination problems in the economics of Keynes. And we won't be able to do more than an introduction on this, but I'd like to at least get started, and then next week we'll pick up the more technical elements. This phrase, the economics of Keynes, comes from a book of Axel Leeuwenhoek's of the 1960s, which was called The Economics of Keynesian Economics and the Economics of Keynes. So he wanted to make a distinction, and he wanted to claim that what was circulating as Keynesian economics actually had a very complex and, in some cases, not very much relation to the economics of Keynes altogether. My view of the economics of Keynes is not exactly the same as Leeuwenhoek's idea, although I haven't gone back and reread that book, so it may be closer than I think. But what I would argue is that the economics of Keynes explicitly addresses the shortcomings of Walrasian supply-demand economic theory in analyzing pervasive features of industrial capitalist economies. And the features that were of particular interest to Keynes were the ones that were wrecking up British and European society in his lifetime, which were slumps, recessions, unemployment, inflations, booms, and bubbles, and that kind of thing. These are phenomena that we have come, partly as a result of Keynes's intervention, to call macroeconomic and to distinguish them from microeconomic. But if you think about them, they all have a strong flavor of social coordination problem about them. because there are situations in which the individual pursuit of individual rational goals, profit, payoff of households and so forth, and firms, seems to lead to socially uncoordinated outcomes like inadequate aggregate demand, involuntary unemployment, excess capacity, and so forth, that no one would have chosen if they would make a choice for the whole system. They could be the Pareto ministry, Pareto Barone ministry of socialist ministry of production, and decide everything, internalize all the externalities in that way. Now, there's another theme that I think is in common between Keynes and what we've been talking about. We saw in the discussion of Smith and the division of labor that there's a very close relationship between this problem of the division of labor and the hub and spoke idea and money, and that it's much easier to understand monetary exchange as arising in a specialized division of labor kind of economy, and that then you have purchase and sale separated. Now, in this particular respect, Keynes does talk about this all the time. He insists again and again that you have to think of the industrial capitalist economy as a monetary economy. And what he means by that is not always so clear to modern economists. What does it mean that it's a monetary economy? Ricardo says money is a veil. So even if it's a monetary economy, but money is a veil, what difference does it make? It should be just the same as if it's not a monetary economy, but Keynes constantly asserts that. And I think it's interesting and important in your reading of Keynes to remember that he not only lived through the transition from the gold standard as it had evolved up to the Great War, what we call World War I, to central bank managed monetary systems, but he was himself personally intimately involved in every one of those transitions. Because during the war, he was in the British Treasury operating their currency and monetary resources. That was his job. And as a result, he knew all the people very well who were in the British Central Bank. He met all the Americans who were in the Fed, and he knew all the Germans and everybody. He had a very good personal knowledge of that process. It was his unusual position as an advisor to the British Treasury and then as a member of the British delegation to the Versailles Peace Treaty, which is where he wrote his breakthrough book, The Economic Consequences of the Peace, right? Which definitely put this question of what was the Versailles Treaty going to do to European monetary relations right in the center of the whole story. And in that sense, perhaps in that sense more than in any analytical sense, Keynes was a very smart man. He was what the British call a clever person. Now, when they say that, watch out a little bit. If they call you a clever person, it's a two-edged sword. It's definitely a compliment, but it's not just a compliment. So he was undoubtedly a very clever person. It's not, he was not, in some respects, as innovative a theoretical or mathematical thinker as some of the other people that he knew, like Frank Ramsey, for example, who was his associate at Cambridge in the 1920s, who died tragically before he could fulfill all of his promise. But he developed a whole range of what we think of as modern mathematical economics really traces back to Ramsey, much more than to Keynes. But he was considerably ahead of his contemporaries in his understanding of the technical operation, opportunities, and policy pitfalls of managed money systems. That's where Keynes had the comparative advantage. He knew what power central banks had and what power monetary policy had, in a way that other people only vaguely got a sense of. What about Keynes and specialization? Well, as we've seen, an important bifurcation in economic theory rests on whether we assume that typical producers, including household suppliers of labor power, operate with non-convex production possibilities and therefore specialize what commodity they supply to the market, or with convex production possibilities and therefore ordinarily diversify their production. This theme, if you're interested in it, there's a wonderful article by Marty Weitzman that was published in the Quarterly Journal of Economics in 1982 that argues that there's no way to understand involuntary unemployment without assuming non-convexity of production. So if you want to think about tying up these ends, you might want to look at that paper. It's also a beautiful paper that provides an alternative to the hub and spoke model as a model of equilibrium in that respect. It's important that we realize that the assumption of convexity of convex production sets and preferences is central to the doctrines of marginalist economics, because it's the only setting in which you have convex constraints and concave objective functions where Lagrangian first order conditions are sufficient as well as necessary for maximization, and therefore the shadow prices of the Lagrangian system can be interpreted as a theory of prices, which is basically what marginalism is. Marginalism is the theory that market prices are the reflection of scarcity, of social scarcity of resources, right? Which, if you translate that into mathematical terms, is precisely this idea that they are Lagrange multipliers for the social allocation problem. Let me just, as one final introductory point, and then we'll pick up the Keynes tradition, the Keynes material next week, to remind ourselves of something important, which is that this emergence of convexity and mathematical maximization as key to neoclassical economics only took place after Keynes did his main work, and actually after he died. So that's characteristic of the general equilibrium work that Arrow and Debreu did, which was first published in 1951 after the Second World War. Very interesting thing to follow up is Phil Murawski's story of how that emerged in Machine Dreams, of how that emerged from the military interest in operations research and the application of mathematics to planning problems and military problems, strategic problems. So but that was after Keynes. That was also where Leontiev got his big boost, because Leontiev's what people thought input-output would be excellent for was targeting strategic bombs. Because if you could figure out which plants to knock out that would really wreck the German economy, then you could maximize the effect of strategic bombing. So all of those ways of looking at the world, which have become sort of second nature to us and they're in the economics textbooks, were post-Keynes, were really after Keynes. Where Keynes started was from Alfred Marshall, and the Marshallian tradition in economics is extremely fascinating, I think worth some more thinking about from this point of view. Because I think Marshall had tried to work both sides of the street. Marshall did understand the social coordination problem, but he tried to segregate it into what he called long-run equilibrium. So Marshall's short-run equilibrium is a market clearing equilibrium in which the typical firm is a price taker, is accepting prices as given, and is equating marginal cost to the market price, and its output decision has no effect we'll see that this is a key point in reconstructing a lot of this Keynes ideas. But Marshall, if you read, and I suggest it's worth, it's nobody ever wants to do this because it's the way in the back of the book of Principles of Economics, and it's very, gives you a headache to read it. But go back and look at Marshall's discussion of technological and pecuniary economies and diseconomies of scale from this point of view. Because what he calls technological economies of scale are interactions of firms in the long run where they change the level of their average of each firm's average cost curves. But you see, changing the level of the average cost curve as opposed to moving along the average cost curve is exactly the social coordination problem, right? It's because that's moving along the horizontal axis of the social interaction model. Everybody else in your industry has expanded output. What's your best response? Well, you find out because they've all increased output that they've congested the resources, and so your average costs are higher, right? And therefore, you're going to have a different best response output than you would have if they hadn't. That's very explicit in that part of Marshall. And it's a part of the notion of Marshallian equilibrium. If you want to follow up on this, there's a very nice piece by Tom Paley that he published in 1990, trying to look at the survey of, as a survey of important contributions to this general line of thinking about macroeconomics as arising from uninternalized externalities. So we've now reached the end of class time, and see you next week.